Hello, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us today for Mental Health Resources Across Nebraska, an online discussion event. I'm Quinn Lewandowski, a senior research specialist at the University of Nebraska Public Policy Center and the current president of the Nebraska State Suicide Prevention Coalition. This event is the second event held by Nebraska Public Media focused on mental health, inspired by the recent documentary Hiding in Plain Sight, Youth Mental Health, a film presented by Ken Burns and directed by Christopher Lauren Ewers and Eric Ewers, that premiered on PBS. You just saw the trailer for the film, which gives a sense of the scope, share stories from youth from all different walks of life, dealing with their own mental health and mental illness. Throughout the program, you'll also hear directly from Nebraskans sharing their own mental health stories and expertise in pre-recorded videos. Today, we're going to talk about mental health resources across Nebraska. We'll touch on how access to resources is a challenge and how we see that impact through individual stories. We'll also talk about the ways providers, organizations, and individuals across the state are trying to reduce that access gap. We'll also share resources and organizations that are statewide and that have a particularly rural focus, so that people know where to reach out. My work and research focuses on behavioral health and policy, and I'm so happy to be joined by these wonderful experts here today who will also contribute to the discussion around statewide mental health resources. I'm going to let each of them introduce themselves. Sami Bradley, can we start with you?
Sure. Hi, everyone. I'm Sami Bradley, and I'm the Associate Vice President for Early Childhood Mental Health at the Nebraska Children and Families Foundation. I work specifically with the Rooted in Relationships Initiative, collaborating with state and community partners to develop systems of care that support social and emotional well-being of children birth through age eight. Before I was in this role, I was a licensed mental health practitioner in Holdridge, Nebraska, and currently I'm also co-leading the Nebraska Association for Infant Mental Health, and I have some experience in early intervention as well. So I'm really excited to be here.
And Dr. Barbara Butes?
Yes, I'm very happy to be here, Quinn. I am a member of the Yankton Sioux tribe of South Dakota, and I'm also a Mdewankatowan from Minnesota. So I have relatives on both sides of the river. I am an anthropologist trained as a sociocultural anthropologist, and in a former life, I was a professor of anthropology. I've come to work with a K through 12 group in Lincoln, Nebraska at the Lincoln Public Schools as an American Indian coordinator. And I've recently come on board with the Department of Education, and I work as the American Indian liaison. And I'm trying to build a network, a system that will allow us to offer the same excellent wraparound services to all the students in Nebraska. It seems that we have more access to mental health services in the urban areas of Omaha and Lincoln. And the further we get into rural communities, the fewer resources there are. And I want to see ways that we've come to a place in the technological world where we can bring these resources to people who need them, to the children and to the adults. And so I really appreciate being here and the work being done to draw attention to this issue.
Thank you, Barbara. And finally, we have Dr. Catherine Jones-Hazledine.
Yeah, thank you. I'm very happy to be here as well. My name is Dr. Kate Jones-Hazledine, and I'm a licensed clinical psychologist. I'm the owner of an organization called Western Nebraska Behavioral Health. And we have a series of eight different, mostly integrated care clinics in the Panhandle and the Sand Hills part of the state of Nebraska. I also, along with Dr. Tara Wilson, am the co-director of Panhandle Beacon, which is the Behavioral Health Education Center of Nebraska. And we do a lot of work with workforce development and recruitment and retention in the state. And then finally, I do work with Chadron State College and the University of Nebraska Med Center as an adjunct faculty, particularly in training clinical students at kind of all levels, some master's level students, practicum students, doctoral interns, and postdoctoral fellows. So.
Awesome. Thank you. And rounding out our live panel today, is our good friend, Mr. Ben Sparks, providing ASL interpretation. Thank you, Ben. We're glad to have you here help and make this event more accessible. We also have Sadie Hinkle from the Kim Foundation and Matt Caesar from the Boys Town National Hotline as guest moderators in the chat, providing additional resources and support if needed. As we go through the event today, we welcome your questions. You can put those questions directly in the chat box at any time, and we will try our best to answer them live. Thanks again for everyone being here. I'm really excited to talk to all of you about suicide prevention resources available in Nebraska and highlight this great documentary. First, I just wanted to give everybody a lay of the land when we think about mental health and how that intersects across rural areas. Today is actually National Rural Health Day, so this is a great day to highlight this aspect of overall health and well-being. According to the National Institute of Health data, 20% of the U.S. population lives in rural areas where only 10% of doctors practice. That's any kind of physician, not just mental health. The Behavioral Health Education Center of Nebraska also reports that 88 of Nebraska's 93 counties are mental health professional shortage areas. Also, about 20% of our youth ages 3 to 18 live with some sort of mental health condition. And for adults, that same number holds true. 1 in 5 Nebraskans have some kind of mental illness. So taking a look at these numbers and how they intersect, I want to talk about some of the trends and patterns that we are currently seeing related to behavioral health and treatment access in rural areas. Dr. Kate, I wanted to start with you to give an overview of how you have seen mental health access and trends shift or change as a provider in Western Nebraska.
Yeah, thank you, Quinn. So I've been back out here. I'm from these rural areas originally, and so I've been back out here about 18 years now providing care, and I really have seen some kind of ebbing and flowing over time. I think, you know, these areas that what you quoted, the 88 out of 93 counties, that's sort of the mantra that we live by as we try to talk about training students and expanding our workforce. And that has been the case the entire time, really, that I've been back here providing services. I think we have seen more care available over that time. One of the problems is that our workforce in rural areas in particular is aging. And so what that means is that as quickly as we can train some students, we have providers who are maybe retiring out of the workforce. And so it's sort of a constant battle to keep those numbers up. And the other thing that happens is that we struggle to retain people providing services in rural areas. And a lot of that has to do with the fact that these areas aren't just shortage areas for, you know, mental health. They're shortage areas for a lot of things. They're shortage areas for physical health care, for kind of supplemental resources and organizations, for entertainment. In our community, you know, we don't have stoplights, which is, you know, not a huge thing, but I mean, they're just short of a lot of things. And so what that means is that providers, unless they have a strong tie to a rural community, they may not stay there. So then we're battling that issue with retention. I think in terms of trends, providers in kind of all areas, but especially rural areas, have seen a real increase in need, especially over these last couple of years. our rural settings have always been kind of areas of boom and bust, and they've always been vulnerable to disaster and to floods and to storms and to loss of crops and things that really hit people hard. And then COVID was layered on top of that. So every agency that I know in our rural settings is currently full to capacity and has waiting lists, 2 months, 3 months, 6 months, which is really hard, especially when you see through a film like this or day to day in our clinics, what people are facing.
Thank you, Kate. Barbara, you've traveled and visited school districts across Nebraska, particularly to assess the systems that support mental health and well-being. And what have you seen?
Well, the need for mental health counseling is high. But in American Indian communities, we have a little bit different culture. Our Native communities have their own system of handling mental health and physical well-being. And, you know, sometimes American Indians are reluctant to access services, even if they're there. And I think there's a need to make mental health services more attractive to American Indians, to make it available, but also make it attractive enough for the people to access. We don't want them to be different. We're not trying to change anything. And of course, if they don't want to come, or if they want to use their own remedies or treatments, that's good. Maybe we can work together with the Western mental health care providers and handle some of these problems that are really current. They're new, they're modern. And very much like Dr. Kate said, you know, in the last 2 years, there's been very little opportunity for our kids to get out and socialized. And so even if they did have a movie theater or stoplights in their town, they're just weren't enough opportunities for the kids to get out and enjoy socializing and doing fun things together. Even school, you know, the schools were closed. Tribal offices were closed. The tribal governments weren't dealing with outsiders, and only with their own people in certain cases, you know, because the COVID hit those American Indian communities hard, and they just tried to stay away from each other. This was really hard. And American Indian people, children and adults, the suicide rate just spiked. I mean, it's still high right now. But our kids, and between the ages of 10 and 24, the rate went up 39%. In the last 2 years. And so I think that if we bring the services to these children where they are and work it out in a way that makes them see that what they do is fine and good, and we can work together and solve these issues, there really is hope. We can plant the seeds of hope and help them see a way that's bright and full of possibilities. I think that's the number one thing we need to do, building the relationships between the service providers and the communities, and figuring out what will bring these children, what will bring these communities hope.
Sami, what are some of the biggest needs or areas of concern that you see when you work with children and families through either the foundation or through your past work as a therapist in rural Nebraska?
I think just to kind of add on to what Kate and Barbara have already talked about, that when you're thinking about early childhood mental health. So kiddos under eight, that all of those needs are really just escalated. So there's a few evidence-based practices, especially when you're looking at interventions specifically that are geared towards young children in their families, child-parent psychotherapy, child-parent psychotherapy and parent-child interaction therapy are two of them that we support here in Nebraska. And as hard as it can be in the waiting list that Kate was referring to earlier, they're just that much harder when you are looking at someone that specializes and has some experience in early childhood mental health. So I think, especially when we're thinking about the intervention side, that it's just escalated a little bit more difficult to find therapists, especially that have had that training opportunity.
Thanks, Sami. And we had our first audience question. This one's from Joy. What is being done to supplement areas that lack providers? Are there any peer group counseling opportunities? So two questions there. What is being done to supplement areas that lack providers?
Well, I think that I'm very happy to report that there are some things like that happening in Indian country. In fact, in northern Nebraska, we have some what's called Hope Squad. There's some up and running. And what that is, there are students in a school, let's say, in a high school, let's say, who are identified by their peers as being reliable, dependable people, that someone they would be able to talk to or go to if they had a problem. And these people who the students have identified are trained in ways to recognize depression and suicidal ideations. And they can actually go and talk to the students that they see having issues. And it works really well. And it's something I wish we could get in more schools. But it's not supported everywhere across Nebraska.
Yeah, I think, Barbara, we have seen the Hope Squad in a couple of our schools out this direction. I agree. I think those are great starts on providing more of a natural support system and more of a peer-based support system. And I do think that that's one direction that will really help to offset some of the lack. Some of the other things that we do to try to supplement the provider base, we do more and more telehealth all the time.
Right.
And so telehealth has really especially increased during COVID, but many of us in rural practice were using it before COVID even hit as a way of, you know, meeting that need in between. So for example, some of the clinics that we go to are a 2-hour drive each direction. So it's a 4-hour round trip and making that multiple times a week or even every week can be really difficult. But if you can make that trip every other week and you can supplement in between with telehealth, or if there's a need for a specialty provider that's just not available, we can sometimes bring that special care in via telehealth. So I think that's been big. In terms of the part of the question addressing the peer aspect, there are also more and more things over the last few years, I think, like QPR trainings, right? In our rural communities, and mental health first aid, and just ways that, for example, Panhandle Public Health in our area and Western Community Health Resources are reaching out and helping to provide information for folks to be able to help each other better.
Awesome. Thanks, Kate. Next, we're going to hear from a young Nebraskan named Marley. She shares her story of dealing with her mental well-being, including having to travel great distances to see a therapist.
I have been struggling with mental illness for, I guess, like 10 or 11 was when I first started having issues with anxiety and having panic attacks. And I started kind of struggling with when I was about 12 with depression and having suicidal ideation and started self-harming around that age. There was this time when actually I was studying abroad the summer after my freshman year of college, and I was sexually assaulted when I was there. And my first impulse was I just had so much of the self-hatred and blame and guilt of what had happened that I wanted to self-harm again. Tattoos actually became like a different way that like I was experiencing like the pain, but it was in a way that was creating art. The whole idea of like a semicolon as a sentence is where you could put a period, but you don't, you continue the sentence. For me, it's representative then instead of like ending my life when I could have, because I have survived through like 2 suicide attempts from when I was like 16. I was depressed. I didn't have a reason to live. I didn't see a point. And for me, it was like, I got this tattoo when I was 18, and it was just kind of the symbol of, wow, I made it to 18. I didn't think I was gonna live this long. I mean, I grew up in Alma, it's a rural area, so to get to a counseling appointment, it would be like an hour round trip to be able to go and see a counselor. The accessibility of counseling and the specific type of counseling that I needed wasn't available. Probably like in my freshman year of college, I decided to go see a counselor at UNL. It was actually through that I was able to get other diagnoses to treat things, like finding out that I had borderline personality disorder, or figuring out that I was suffering not just from anxiety, but also this was PTSD that I was experiencing. I have made so much progress in the last year and a half, thanks to doing this kind of therapy. It's something that's really changed my life a lot.
That was a clip from Nebraska, our young Nebraskan Marley. We'll be seeing several of these clips throughout our event today from fellow Nebraskans. Marley's story really shows the gap that we see sometimes when providers in rural areas are far away and sometimes are not available because of long waiting lists. What are some ways that we're trying to mitigate the shortage of providers? Kate, you're involved with Beacon, the Behavioral Health Education Center of Nebraska. How are you prioritizing recruiting providers to rural areas in Nebraska?
Yeah. So that's really, that's Beacon's whole mission. And Beacon was established in 2009 for folks who don't know of that agency. And the real goal of Beacon is this dual part of recruiting and retaining providers and developing a workforce and training a workforce. And so Beacon does things like reaches students early on in high school, in undergraduate, in grad school, in residencies, and helps to provide information and training to guide them into the Nebraska workforce and support them while they do that. There's also funding involved in it to allow students to have some stipends and some funding during that important training. And then also Beacon has developed networks to support the providers who are already in place, because we know, again, the turnover can be really high. And so we want to keep the providers who have a particular passion for living and working in rural settings and with underserved populations. So for those providers, we need to provide the training they need. We need to provide the support they need. We need to put together some networks to help them feel more connected so that they're not as professionally isolated. And in those ways, we're hoping to continue to develop this pipeline of people into our Nebraska behavioral health workforce and people who will stay because they're connected to those communities.
I think that some of the schools in Nebraska are really putting the bar high and demonstrating to the communities, that we can take care of our children if we have enough professional development. The counselors are being trained in QPR to be able to recognize and deal with suicidal behavioral or ideations. And we have professional development for teachers. In some districts, all staff, everyone across the board, has to take a suicide training course every year. Before school starts, they do this online little training. It lasts about an hour, where they learn how to talk to someone about suicide and help them get to the help that they need. So we do have some support there in the schools themselves. And I think the 988, the nationwide number for, it's a hotline for suicide and mental health. And what came along with that, a sort of side benefit of it, was the schools had to come up with policies and procedures for ways to deal with a crisis like that. Sometimes a student's in the midst of committing suicide, dying by suicide, and they can be saved right there, because of the policies and procedures that are in place. I'm not saying things are perfect, but I am saying that Nebraska is raising the bar for other people to really see that these issues can be faced addressed head on. And the same is going on the reservations and in American Indian communities. We have places for young people to go, and it's not like treatment. It's like a home where they can go and get counseling and be reintroduced to a school after they've had an episode. And I think this is all very important. And the tribes themselves have taken time at tribal council meetings and to pass resolutions and to set aside funds and hire people to come in and provide those same services on the reservation land on Indian land to give American Indian children treatment and access to other American Indian people who are able to provide those services.
Barbara? We also wanted to kind of talk about the pros and cons of telemedicine. What are all your thoughts on telemedicine, given most of you touch different areas of the state?
Well, I know that on Indian land, a lot of times the connectivity is very spotty. And so everyone can have an internet provider or a hotspot or whatever, and the connection might not be strong enough or reliable enough to carry on a session with a therapist. The telehealth, the person would need to have their computer and to be able to talk to the therapist. I know that the Rosebud up in South Dakota has done some work in that regard, and they have an agreement, and they're putting up some more cell towers to make it possible for a better and more reliable internet connection. And that's really going to help the people in northern Nebraska along the border there to have better connectivity and make telehealth a really reliable resource for mental health therapy.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think telehealth is a really important supplement. We talked about that earlier. I think it's an important way to increase our ability to reach people. But I also think that we don't want to lose sight of the importance of having providers who are embedded in those communities. Right. Because I think that those of us who work in rural settings clinically, we know that one of the features of rural communities is a bit of a distrust of outsiders. that those are close-knit communities and they tend to trust people that they have some knowledge of. Of course, I mean, there's a line there, right? You know, you don't want to necessarily have your therapist be your, you know, next door neighbor, but you do find that rural people are more comfortable receiving services from somebody who is known to them. So I see telehealth as continuing to be an important supplement while we work towards having enough people on the ground, especially, or bringing in specialty care that just isn't available because we're all generalists in rural areas and might need a little extra.
Now, yeah,
I think that,
go ahead, Barbara.
I think that the mental health, sometimes we don't realize how well connected all of the, when Dr. Kate was talking about this traffic light and the movies and all of that, we don't realize how connected all these things are to our mental health. We have to have a balanced life of our spirit and our physical being and also our mental health. It all has to be balanced. And sometimes providing a recreation center or a community center and bringing in activities for the community helps. So I think we need to begin building relationships with everyone to see how we can work together and figure out where our goals intersect and how we can help each other reach those goals. Thank you.
That is so key, and especially the collaboration of especially addressing these gaps, as well as, shifting the shame, getting a shift in our culture to take mental health just as seriously as physical health, because we obviously know that they're both super important in our daily mm-hmm. lives. And we can't have great physical health and poor mental health and vice versa.
Right. Vice versa. That's right.
Yeah. Next, we're going to play another clip now, this time from Colleen New Holly. As we go into this clip, I want to remind everyone that we hope to hear from you. We hope to get to some more questions. If you have any questions of our panelists about any topic, put them in the chat anytime. We'll definitely try to get to as many of them as possible.
I am 24 years old. I'm about to be 25 in February. I am from Pine Ridge, South Dakota, enrolled with the Oglala Sioux tribe. When I was growing up, my parents were having a hard time in their marriage. The walls were pretty thin and, we could hear them shouting in the other room. I have three other siblings. They're all younger than me. It was my job to make sure they were asleep. So when they finally did separate, my father moved out of the house. And after that, it was just constant change. We experienced homelessness. We've experienced, different types of abuse. It was difficult, especially in middle school for me. Like, I never fit in. It was just really hard. And a lot of that came from, what I later learned was, depression. A lot of people think that depression is being really sad. A lot of times it really is just getting up and going about your day, but you're doing it in a way where you're practically a zombie. You're just so tired. You're just so heavy. I know when people hear about the reservation, first thing people think about is, poor Native people who are addicted to drugs and alcohol and, who live in rundown homes. You need to understand that if you're living in a place where you're far away from resources like grocery stores, places to get new clothing, places to get new items for your household, you're not being supported the way you should be in terms of being able to get mental health services, in terms of being able to get even generalized health services. You feel that hopelessness. You feel like you're not worthy of being alive a lot of times. You know, you don't feel like you're even a real human being. But overall, it really does kind of come back to what's called intergenerational trauma. The things that my grandparents and my great-grandparents experienced, you know, has come down and trickled down to me and my siblings, you know, because they've gone through a lot. My grandmother was in boarding school, for instance. She had a lot of issues that she didn't address. That affected how my mother grew up and interacted with people. Down to us, we're realizing that a lot of things in the past affects us to this day. And that does stem back to, you know, colonization and what's happened since then. So there's a lot of history behind a lot of what troubles a lot of people today.
Colleen's story really helps illustrate the complicated and sometimes overlapping factors that can influence mental health and well-being. We have a question from the audience. Do you see different cultural backgrounds having more issues than others or handling mental health better than others? And if there are cultures handling mental health better, how can the rest of our state reach out to adopt the best interventions?
When I look at the suicide, turning to suicide across cultures, it's always different. Some cultures believe suicide is a noble ending, and that it's just fine. And others, I have a belief that the soul will drift around, unable to find peace if they, you know. So I don't think we can just say what suicide means to each culture or across cultures, because it is so different among cultures, and then the individual differences. I know that I have a brother who committed suicide. He died at 70, and he chose to shoot himself. And, you know, I guess we all blamed ourselves. We wondered where we had gone wrong. It was my favorite brother. We don't blame him. We don't think less of him. We still love him and believe that he is in a good place because he made that decision. But we didn't like the way we felt. So I don't know about all cultures, but I can just say that among my people, you know, it has been a way of dealing with things for millennia. During the first colonization in Minnesota, a lot of the women who had been raped were willing to die. They would die by suicide. And the grandmothers would say, don't do that because that child is part of you and we love that child. So I just don't think that there's a single way of looking at suicide, even cross-culturally. I don't know. What do you think, Dr. Kate?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's cultural differences about suicide is such an important part of that topic. And what I also heard Quinn ask too is just in terms of how we in different cultural groups deal with mental health issues and with struggles. Does one group have more difficulty than another? And I guess along the lines, Barbara, of what you were talking about, what I tend to see is that everybody struggles to an extent. And then you have layers, right, of additional struggle. And what we see with many of different cultural groups is, in addition to just the regular pressures of depression and stress and anxiety, you have all of the other things. You have racism and you have poverty and you have, isolation, and you have all sorts of different things. And so I do think we see different populations being hit harder because they're being hit with layers of things. And then with what we've been talking about, so many of the areas of our state are underserved, and that's not new, which means you have generations of people who have not had the resources that they need to be well and to stay well and to get well. And so it builds, one generation on top of another in terms of the struggles they're having.
I agree with that. And what Colleen was saying when she was talking about her grandmother having been to boarding school, you know, that's a much bigger issue than most people are aware of. There was 150 years of families being taken apart, just systematically taken apart. And the children grew up in boarding schools where they lived a military existence, not getting the kind of like hugs and night-night stories and kisses and the tenderness that we think of when we think of mother and child. And that went on for generations. That was 150 years. That was several generations of children growing up without even traditional family organization. The traditional family organization was taken apart. And so there have been generations of children. My mother was in boarding school, but her mother was not in boarding school except for a short time. She went because she couldn't quit dancing, but the missionaries made her go to boarding school because she wouldn't quit dancing. But there was no, I mean, they loved each other, but there was no visible, no sense of it. We weren't raised with a great deal of that, that mothering. And we have a saying now that we're breaking the cycle. We have to get well. We have to heal ourselves to save the future generations. And families are beginning to recognize that. And I think that's another reason why it's important for us to at least introduce our kids to some of the ideas that you learn in QPR and in the ASSIST and some of the programs that are available to train trainers for dealing with people who are having suicidal ideations.
Thank you, Dr. Butts, and thank you for sharing your story there. And so sorry for the loss of your brother, and especially those in the chat that share their similar experiences. I'm sorry for your loss. But we're truly here for you. Sami, I wanted to talk a little bit more directly to you. How do we see the complex factors of distance, poverty, and more, and how does it intersect when it comes to early childhood mental health?
Yeah, I think, like I said earlier, it feels like in the early childhood world, everything is just exaggerated from the issues that we have. I think also some just confusion about early childhood mental health and what it entails in general. When we say that, people kind of picture a baby on a couch getting therapy. And that's definitely not what we're talking about when we talk about early childhood mental health. When we talk about early childhood mental health, we're talking about everything from promoting positive social emotional development through intervention as well. So we're talking about that full range of building positive supports up, kind of like what Barbara was talking about, you know, so that the cycle doesn't keep getting repeated. And so really childhood mental health is all about talking about relationships and everything that, you know, impacts a young child's developing capacity to experience, manage, regulate, and express emotions. So how they form close and secure relationships, how they explore the environment and learn, like that's, and all of that is in the context of their family, their community, and their culture. So I think, you know, going back to thinking about generational traumas that have happened, that's where early childhood mental health can be so powerful. Because if the sooner that we can break in and support young children and the families that are supporting the caregivers, childcare providers, and the families that are supporting them, it feels like that's where we can make some change happen. And as far as, you know, thinking about extra issues, I think it is just finding the right people that have that knowledge base, because we don't learn a lot about that. And I didn't learn a lot about early childhood mental health in my program. And I think programs are adding more of those pieces in, but continuing to get that training out there all the way from the promotion level to the therapist and the doctor. Like I think we have really smart, great people in Nebraska. And so really spreading out that expertise, you know, again, related to the QPR, there's some great trainings and, you know, promoting type of programs that are in early childhood as well.
Thanks, Sami. Now we're going to play another clip from another Nebraskan and a good friend of mine, Sonny Cochran, who is the head of the Nebraska Extension Rural Wellness, Rural Family Stress and Wellness Team. She's a certified QPR trainer. She also has personal experience with losing, with a brother dying by suicide and other family members that have had mental health challenges. She shares her experiences being based in rural Nebraska and resources that are available through the Rural Wellness Team.
The Rural Family Stress and Wellness Working Group is a collaborative group of a lot of different folks who are really passionate about our rural communities and our families. And they're passionate about all families. It's just that we know there are some unique challenges in rural areas. We have long days for folks that are working off the farm and then come home and work at night with their families and on the farm. And then we're also at the mercy of the prices, what's going on in the world. You know, I grew up in a farm family. My dad and mom would never have talked about what was going on in the farm, whether there were challenges. You know, it's a little bit of that stoicness that we have in our rural communities, you know, that Nebraska strong part that you're not going to share that with your neighbors and your family. Opening the door to these conversations to try and reduce that stigma in our rural communities, it's not easy. QPR stands for Question, Persuade, Refer. And it's a gatekeeper training to help all of us look for those signs and ways we can help someone who may be having some challenges and having a crisis. And it helps us to ask a question if someone might need help and is thinking of suicide, and to refer them to help. One of the myths is if you ask someone if they're thinking about suicide or ending their life, that will put their thought into their head. And that is not true. It is a myth. And most people, when you ask that question, if you're concerned about someone, will actually be relieved there's someone they might be able to talk to, or someone has brought it up and they're not keeping that inside. So we always encourage everyone, you know, offer hope, ask the question.
And it's great to hear from Sani there. I'm actually a member of the Rural Family Stress and Wellness Team as well. And one of the things that we do a part of that group is we want to try to reduce the stigma of talking about mental health issues and ways to make awareness of mental health and well-being more integrated in our daily lives, especially as Native rural Nebraskans and rural Nebraskans out there. In some ways, this is really talking about both intervention, you know, a direct effort to prevent a person or persons from attempting to take their own life or lives, and preventions, a way of addressing some problems before they start. Sami, before we get into some audience questions, can you talk a little bit about some of your work with Rooted in Relationships and other initiatives working to address some of these issues?
Yeah, there is some really exciting and great work happening in Nebraska around early childhood mental health, especially preventative. And that's where we've tried to focus and through intervention as well. But some examples of that are the pyramid model, which is an evidence-based framework that supports young children by really promoting positive social emotional development, supporting intentional teaching of social emotional skills, such as good problem solving, how to be a good friend, those kind of things, and then all the way up to more intervention type where you have a plan. So really starting at that base, thinking about relationships, setting up an environment for children to succeed, and then building upon that. So pyramid model is being implemented in childcare centers and homes and school districts across the state. Circle security parenting and circle security classroom is another great preventative practice that is like a parenting program that really supports building relationships and is available in many areas of the state. And then if it's not available, those programs are available via technology as well. So really trying to build some infrastructure around those practices so that they can be more accessible and are available more statewide. So in the intervention realm, we have the Nebraska Center for the Vulnerable Young Child has some great resources where you can access, you know, therapists that have had child parent psychotherapy training or parent child interaction therapy, some of those identified models that we know that there's evidence behind that support young children. There's just the Nebraska Association for Infant Mental Health has a great website that links most of the resources that are available in Nebraska around early childhood mental health. So great supports for families and young children on there.
Awesome. Thanks, Sami. We'll go with an audience question. And there's probably a lot of parents tuning in. The question is, what is the best way to reach a high school or college age student to encourage them to go into behavioral health?
As a career is how I'm hearing that, Quinn, is that right?
That seems how, yeah.
Yeah. So, boy, there's not enough time to talk about this, but this is a particular passion of mine. There's a camp that we've been doing for the last 10 years out here in Rushville, Nebraska, Chadron, Nebraska, which is just that. So it's called Farm Camp, which has nothing to do with farming. But the idea is that we identify students who are questioning different careers or maybe have expressed an interest in behavioral health careers. We bring them in for a week and we teach them about different aspects of behavioral health, and they meet different providers who do that work in rural settings, and we attach them to mentors. I think we want to provide information and connection and a pathway, and then we follow those students throughout the rest of their schooling so that they have that kind of support and can ask questions or ask for letters of recommendation or ask advice about what classes to take. So I think that's a really powerful way. And Beacon has been really generous in supporting that for a number of years so that rural students don't have any cost associated with exploring those careers.
Thanks, Dr. Kate. Next, I'll get a quick reaction from one of you. How does socioeconomics play with mental health? Such as, are there differences between privileged and non-privileged families or communities?
I think that the communities, it doesn't really matter. There are some very well-adjusted people who are extremely poor and some very poorly adjusted people who are very wealthy. And I think it goes back to this SEL business of how well do they handle their emotions and how good are the is their ability to problem solve and that sort of thing. I think those that means more really than socioeconomic condition, unless we're talking about having access to care. And then, of course, it never hurts to have money when you're trying to meet with a physician or a therapist, either money or access to other means.
And especially our rural communities, you know, sometimes it's hard for a parent to take off 2 hours of work to drive 30 minutes into an appointment for a 1 hour appointment and drive 30 minutes back. That's always a challenge. Some people are able to do that or have the flexibility to do that
right.
A little bit more. Yeah. We also had a question, and I'm so sorry for your loss. Somebody lost somebody to suicide this past year, and they're really looking for more resources for themselves and their family. For suicide loss survivors and just general suicide prevention resources. And Sadie did a good job of sharing some resources in the chat, but anything off the cuff from any of you on that topic?
Out of Darkness, is that I think that's a really good organization for, you know, getting like group support and activities that help you feel as if you're at least coming to a closure.
Yeah. And Alliance of Hope is another online survivors of suicide loss coming together. Great online forum to interact with people that have gone through losing someone to suicide as well. I recommend that one myself.
We have postvention organizations here in Nebraska, and sometimes they work very well for prevention as well, because, you know, sometimes if your parent commits suicide, then sometimes that it'll have a domino effect. So postvention treatment, we do have that here in Nebraska. And I can't think of the name right. It's called Morning Hope or something.
Yep, Morning Hope here in Lincoln. They do some amazing
work.
There was also some mention of the Nebraska Lost Teams and other things of that nature.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And fortunately, as our time is dwindling, we'll transition to our next clip. We're going to do one more last clip before having a little bit more time for discussion. NAMI, the National Alliance on Mental Illness, is the nation's largest grassroots mental health organization dedicated to building better lives for millions of Americans affected by mental illness. And great news, NAMI Nebraska is now in all six of the state's behavioral health regions. We talked with Executive Director Corinne Meadows about some of the mental health services they provide statewide.
So NAMI Nebraska not only provides free support services to individuals with a mental health condition, but we also provide free support groups to family members and providers throughout the community. All of our NAMI programs are led by peers, and so they have an understanding of what that individual is going through, and it provides a more empathetic environment to those who are participating. We have everyone who has simple anxieties to severe mental illnesses that participate in our classes. It's harder to talk about mental health in rural communities, because everybody knows everybody. And it's hard to be able to say, I need help, or my family member needs help, or this is what we're struggling with, because if I tell someone at the coffee shop, everybody's gonna know. The wonderful thing about NAMI is everything we do is free and everything we do is confidential. And the wonderful thing about our support groups that are virtual is you can hop on and that person does not necessarily have to say, my name is Corinne Meadows and I live in Omaha, Nebraska. And I think it's even more great is when in January, when it's going to be 50 below here in Nebraska and icy, I could hop on to a support group in Hawaii and I could be like, oh boy, it's nice and warm here. You know, if the only time that works for me to join a support group is at 2 o'clock in the afternoon on a Tuesday and there's one in Virginia, I can hop on. And the other positive thing is that there are support groups that are in other languages besides English. So we are able to help connect individuals to support groups that they would not have been able to be connected to if we didn't have this virtual capability. We are working with NAMI Kansas within the agricultural community to get a connection support group going virtually for the farmers because we know that they are really struggling right now, but we wanna make sure that we are there to help support them. And so this will be a agricultural virtual connection support group that is for the farmers, and it is going to be led, facilitated by a farmer so that they can understand and be able to relate to what they are all going through. And it's not by someone who really doesn't understand what it's like to be a farmer today. These people are looking for hope. They're looking for support. They're looking for help. They want to know that they're not alone. And that's the wonderful thing that we are continuing to see is that everyone right now is struggling with something, right? And we are all coming together to show that support and to show that you're not the only one going through this. You're here as a community and as a state, as NAMI, as a family, we are here to support you.
And you can find one of NAMI's online support groups at naminebraska.org. That's N-A-M-I, nebraska.org. They also offer support groups for family members going through their family-to-family classes, and their programs and services include presentations for churches, online training seminars for mental health providers, including teachers, doctors, foster parents, all of which are crucial support, especially in rural communities. We're so happy to have NAMI as one of several Nebraska organizations to work on this. And kind of transitioning to some audience questions, what are some other ways people can take action and seek out resources?
Well, you can always, if you're a child, you can always go to your school counselor and ask. It would be a good starting point. And also at the medical facility, you can call and they can give you good advice or direction.
And that's what I was going to say, Barbara. I think very often our clinics are specifically integrated for that reason, to be able to collaborate with our primary care docs. But even clinics that don't have integrated behavioral health staff always, in my experience, have a referral list, have a list of providers who are local or available to provide some support.
C see. I'm just trying to find something. And it, I guess my next question for the group is of those after, you've taken the loved one to the hospital, they've maybe spent some time and are discharged. What's some great advice to the family as they transition back to normal or the new normal? What's some advice that you would give to a family or loved one making that transition from an attempt or suicidal ideation back home?
I think everybody in the family needs to have some sort of counseling or therapy to understand themselves and to be able to work together.
I agree. And I think those hospitalizations in our state tend to be very short term, right? They tend to be, 24, 48, 72 hours. And so that means that people tend to still be on the cusp of crisis when they come out. And so it's really, really important that there be some support kind of immediately available, even if that's so mostly hospitals, when they discharge, will have contacted some sort of behavioral health agency to schedule an appointment. But that appointment might be a week or 2 weeks down the road. And so, continuing to have kind of supervision and support available in the meantime, and working with the school, if it's a youth especially, so that student can be kind of brought back into the school setting in a way that is less stressful and more supportive for them.
Amy, your thoughts?
I was just kind of echoing what Kate and Barb said, and just thinking, always try to think of a family as like a mobile, right? So when you hit a baby mobile, you'll hit one of them, it impacts everybody. So thinking about support for, of course, for the individual, but also for the rest of the family members, and how, as the change of them going in and then coming out, that how much of an impact that has on the whole family system, is thinking that to be aware and cognizant of that.
Awesome. Thank you. And especially all of you, as well as some of your colleagues, have done a tremendous job of raising up systems. Dr. Butts and some of your colleagues, and working with schools on prevention, postvention, and intervention policies, et cetera, which a lot of times in our rural communities, that's so key with our children. So with Beacon and Nebraska Children and Families Foundation, you guys do some tremendous work. So I applaud that. Let's see. I also wanted to talk about the importance of peer support. This goes back to kind of normalizing and destigmatizing the discussion of mental health. How can we make checking in on each other a little bit more routine?
I think one thing that I like to really think about for people is the idea of the difference between sympathy and empathy, and that idea that the more we get comfortable kind of sitting in those difficult emotions with our peers, and when we start modeling that at a very young age, that makes that not so uncomfortable as you grow up if you have that experience. So I think more we model it to young children, that eventually, hopefully, it becomes easier. But the idea of that we can't always fix everything, but most people just want someone there beside them. Sometimes sitting in that pain with them for a while, it's a better place to be when you're not alone.
Yeah,
I think.
Sorry, Barbara.
Go ahead.
Well, I was going to say, Sami, I think too that you really hit the nail on the head with it, with talking about that modeling aspect and starting young. To me, so much of that has to do too with how with that social emotional aspect, even within the school curriculums, where we can help kids get better at talking about their own emotions and recognizing emotions in other people, and how to appropriately and respectfully ask the questions.
All right.
And
sorry, Dr. Butes, as we're coming to the end tonight, again, we've had such an active chat tonight. We're so grateful for everybody sharing their stories and experiences. We're sorry we couldn't get to every question because our time is so short. I wanted to ask everybody for their final thoughts about this, our topic tonight. Dr. Butes, I would like to start with you first.
I think that we cannot forget about self-care. We must care for ourselves. We work with situations that break our hearts, that sometimes keep us awake, even though we try to not let that happen. And we need to practice self-care and find that happy place every day in our minds, or if we're lucky, we can go there. And just love yourself and love each other. We need a lot more love in this world. And if we can do that, we'll be able to understand the people we're working among and see them for them and realize that everybody has their own spirit. So care for yourself and love yourself.
Thank you. Sami, we'll do you next, your final thoughts on our topic tonight.
Yeah, I think I'm just really, I'm grateful for this opportunity to be here with everybody. And I'm grateful that we have so many people in the audience that are understanding how important this really is. And that the more that we can continue to have these conversations with each other, it makes me really hopeful for our future, that we can continue to make a positive difference and move forward so that we're not stuck. And so I'm feeling really grateful and hopeful right now about this.
Awesome. Thanks, Sami. Dr. Kate, final thoughts?
Yeah, Sami, I agree so much. I think that you really echoed what my thoughts were, that feeling of hopefulness. And we've talked a bit about some of the particular obstacles in our state to access, and especially in rural settings. But I also want to end with highlighting the strengths that we have, that these communities are close-knit communities, they're small communities, and they are historically used to taking care of each other in those communities. And that is a real strength when it comes to things like this. So continuing to think about and talk about and care about our youth, that's leading from our area of strength.
Thank you, Dr. Kate. As far as final thoughts from myself, I mean, this is such an important topic, and I think all my panelists agree during the times where we've gotten discussed, we could probably make this an all day, if not 2 day thing, if we wanted to. Just unfortunately, we're just packed into time, and I wanted to personally thank you all for your participation in the chat tonight, as well as the great support from our panelists tonight, Sami Bradley, Associate Vice President for Early Childhood Mental Health at the Nebraska Children and Families Foundation, Dr. Barbara Butes, anthropologist, researcher, and educational consultant, as well as many other hats, and works for NDE as well. And then Dr. Kate Jones-Hazledine, owner of Western Nebraska Behavioral Health and co-director of Panhandle Beacon. I also want to thank the very active Ben Sparks in the corner up there. Thank you for providing ASL tonight and making this event accessible. Also, thank you, Sadie, as well as Matt, for monitoring the chat tonight, as well as our Nebraska Public Media staff that put this together, as well as our wonderful sponsors. I'm Quinn Lewandowski, Senior Research Specialist at the University of Nebraska Public Policy Center and current president of the Nebraska State Suicide Prevention Coalition. That will bring us to a close tonight. You can watch past events in this series and look up resources at nebraskapublicmedia.org/mentalhealth to learn more about hiding in plain sight. You can visit pbs.org/plain sight. Thank you again for joining us tonight and sharing all your great questions. Have a wonderful evening.